there's a few different types. We've already discussed those with past traumas that weigh them down. But what we haven't yet covered is those that are set adrift due to economic difficulties. The basis for modern society is the ability to comfortably provide food and shelter for oneself and others. It's the base of the hierarchy of needs pyramid for a reason. That takes a certain level of income to maintain, and if all the money dries up, we start losing even the most crucial steps on this pyramid. This leads to a state where individuals, otherwise well-adjusted, are pushed to desperation, moving themselves to new markets in search of the job opportunities that have gone away in their local area. But when everyone else is also suffering during a recession, that leaves a large body of ambling people with no answers for their conditions but the state of the economy. And how vague is that? If only there were a movie that featured a drifter in these exact circumstances to perfectly illustrate the point. Oh wait. A cult classic from 1988, They Live features a man walking into a new life, whereupon he discovers things are rough everywhere, and finally stumbles onto the reason for everyone's currency crisis. It stars the late Roddy Piper as a man without chewing gum and a whole lot of ass to kick. So how could an action movie starring a professional wrestler have anything to say about the sociological impact of recessions? Well, put on these sunglasses and I'll show you. Put on the glasses and I'll show... You think this is funny, don't you? You think I'm doing this because I want to? Put on the damn glass... Oh, okay, okay. I see how it is. You want to deal with this? Okay, okay. Whoa. you think you're bad, don't you? Well, guess what? How bad you would be if you just put on the glass! Okay, you know what? I'm trying to help you here. You don't understand. There's a world beyond which you haven't seen yet. So just put on. What? You think I was gonna stop here? You think this is something that isn't important to me? Okay? Okay. Okay. Peace offering. Oh! Oh, that wasn't nice, was it? Oh no, it wasn't. Oh yeah! Okay, guess what? Put on the glasses! Meet our main character. Well, they must say his name while he's doing paperwork.
Last place of employment?
Denver, Colorado.
Oh, okay. How about when he meets Frank?
You need a place to stay?
Not there either. Well, let's go to the credits. That's why it's so hard to pin it down. He's the man with no name. Sans Pancho. Nada ambles into the urban setting of the new town, making his way to the Office of Financial Concerns first, where he...
Due to a computer error, the food stamp program has been suspended until further notice.
Wait, what? Did I hear that right? Food stamps are suspended due to a computer error. How is everyone okay with this? No one flinches at the news! Actually, this moment is what hooked me right away. It's a background statement that shows how numb people are to their own world. Computer errors are unavoidable, and due to one, an essential service to sustain life must be temporarily suspended. Give me convenience or give me death. Less than 5 minutes in, this setting is already providing rich commentary for sociological norms that are now adopted and constantly shafting people. And I'm discussing the first audible line of the movie. Impress me more, John Carpenter. We learn that Nada is originally from Denver, where the job market dried up overnight, and he used to be a banker of some sorts, when 14 banks suddenly closed there in a year. The unemployment lady doesn't bat an eye at this news and sends him away without hope. When mass closures for a financial institution catering to lower and middle class citizens is something so common as to be unnoteworthy, there is something fundamentally wrong. He eventually gets a gig working for a construction site, where he meets Frank, another man on the outside. Like Nada, Frank is here to pursue work, while his family stays back home. I assume he sends all of his money to them because Frank lives in Justiceville.
Serving the food up soon. Good start. Whoa!
They were voted most ironically named neighborhood of the year. 3 years running. Frank also gives us an insight on his mindset to how the world is going.
The golden rule. He who has the goal makes the rule.
I had no idea the 1% movement started in 1988. This is by far their best film. Justiceville, while lacking in actual homes, does have enough to cover electric costs, because everyone has their TV going. That's a running theme, too. Distraction. While job opportunities are on the decline and people are starting to live on the streets more and more, all efforts are made to make sure the entertainment is up to snuff, specifically television. Even when their lack of funds means they can't feed themselves, there's always a TV nearby for them to become lost in. And I don't mean engaged or enthralled, it's just staring numb at this talking box as the world around them starts to crumble. It's subtle! It's what the first half of this film does, though. It really puts into light what some people have claimed has happened to society since the invention of television. American society in particular seems to have reprioritized perceived need of entertainment over employment, food, and even a roof over our heads at times. If this movie were made today, they'd have everyone watching videos on their smartphones, selling organs to pay for their monthly data fees. However, the audience isn't the only one in on what's going on. Here's proof.
Just...
impulses are being redirected. We are living in an artificially induced state of consciousness that resembles sleep.
WikiLeaks looked a lot different before the internet. These members of the resistance broadcast from a church near Justiceville, where they awkwardly stare at things wearing sunglasses and stage their nightly interrupts in scheduled programming. It's just a little bit of conspiracy theory going through their heads. What harm could it do? At least they're only going after the church. I can see how that's entirely necessary. All of these odd things combined convince Nada to see what the resistance was up to. And when he finds one of those sunglasses and tries them on, exactly what my internet browser looks like. I had the They Live edition of Adblocker. It's sweet. While the magazines may be more boring in this view, what livens it up is what Nada sees in other people.
What's your problem?
The worst result of dermabrasion I've ever seen. That's right, it takes a drifter to see the plain truth that society won't. We're being taken over from within. I'll bring in the DM to elucidate.
I forgot where your logical fallacy was. The other day you came into me and said, I couldn't figure out Full Throttle, but I beat all three missed games. Well, see, that was your downfall. You were expecting logic. You were not expecting to have to use the Kabuki mask in order to get the fake ID to work.
What?
Oh, don't worry your pretty little head about it. This was before your time.
I'll take your word for it. Tell me about They Live.
Ooh, with pleasure. Which part specifically?
The overwhelming control exerted by an unseen controller over mankind's destiny.
It's almost like you know me. The visitors from the system near Andromeda had the perfect solution to take over. Do it without being seen. They planted moles within the ranks of humanity years ago and started broadcasting a signal to guide their entry into civilization. It's exactly how I'd invade.
And that's exactly why your invasions would not succeed, yo.
Excuse me?
Well, it's just like the whole problem of like sneaking in and like winning in from within, yo. It's like one false move and it's all like gone.
They do imply that the invaders would flee like cockroaches once they're discovered.
But at that point, why would it matter? I mean, they already have the infrastructure. They already have the support. Why not just exercise the authority that they already have?
It's all a matter of perception, yo. It's like when the people at the bottom looks up to the tops and sees people that looks like them, then they okay, because they can be like, oh, that's going to be me someday. But when they look to the tops and they see the funky alien dudes, oh, then it's on.
Even though both are doing essentially the same action, when it's not other people oppressing us, it's something worth fighting for.
I guess that makes sense. I mean, when a party member steals from the party, it's just a Tuesday night. However, when a goblin steals from the party, it's World War III.
Perception is everything when it comes to reactions, yo! Think about it! They Live is the prime example of how perception took over the world!
Plus, you gotta account for this line.
You got him. Nick, you saw shaving this morning.
You look as shitty to us as we do to you.
Huh. So our own biases influence basic definitions in our minds.
Not to mention, everyone's eye perception is different. I mean, how do you know what you perceive is the same thing that I perceive?
Shoto yobi ningyo suru no wa iyo.
Same thing everyone else does, Spaniard. It's not only the visual changes that are important, but also the sensory ones as well. Look at this scene.
Don't wear them glasses too long. Starts to feel like a knife turning in your skull.
Excessive use of these signal blockers induces a headache, reinforcing the idea that interrupting the masking beam is bad. It's through television, radio, and all our technology that it's being broadcast.
They mask themselves with a combination of, like, visual and sensory illusions. Now, why wouldn't this work, Les?
Because as soon as the system falters, we're left with the obvious alien staring us in the face.
Would be a cold shock of water for the invasion force. I mean, talk about getting caught with your pants down.
Exactly.
As in this scene.
Hey, what's wrong, baby?
Wait, Calvin, aren't you technically an invading alien?
Well, no. I'm invited now.
Well, how would you do it?
Oh, that's easy, yo. I'd, like, slowly integrate myself into society, earning the love and admiration of all those around me, plus proving myself a valuable asset amongst them. And then, they would eventually welcome my conquering forces under the banner of peace.
I like your style.
Well, thank you guys for completely terrifying me. I'm gonna go now.
Oh, speaking of which, I lost my itinerary. When was the peace conference you scheduled again?
Oh, next 4th of July, yo. Independence Day 2's gonna be screening. It's gonna be great.
So, we have an outsider that the audience identifies with. That's already an interesting development, but it makes sense here. His perspective is ours. Further, Nada speaks for people outside the establishment. See, the aliens aren't the only problems we have. It's also the humans blatantly selling out their own species for personal gain. Yeah, there's a whole league of Judases here. When certain people are allowed exception because they're greasing the right palms, that puts everyone else at a disadvantage. Those outside of the system will never get into it, unless they're willing to be bought. Nada fights for the rights everyone outside the inner circle wants, and that's why this movie is a cult classic. He's the drifter in all of us, just trying to get by and fight against forces that would stop us from doing so. Isn't that what everyone wants? If you disagree, then you're one of them. To everyone else, keep fighting. I'm the other Socio, and I don't have cable TV. I looked under chairs. I looked under tables. I tried to find the key to 50 million fables. They call me the seeker.
To give what I'm after till the day I die. Okay, we meet, we talk peace, we drink 40s, we drink 40s, we talk more peace, we drink 40s, we drink 40s, we talk more feast. Deep sea fangly fish, we talk more peace, 40s, 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 fish, 40s, 40s, peace, 40s, 40s, peace, 40s, 40s.
This is like a party, yo, I wanna come. Is that inviting?
With the keynote speaker, he doesn't even know he's supposed to be there.